In late 2013, I set out to write and edit a 15 to 30 minute YouTube video on the subject of man's pursuit of human equivalent artificial intelligence, but found the subject so broad-ranging and complex that I ended up spending many months exploring the topic. My hundreds of information sources ranged from published science papers, to books written by so-called futurologists, to news media reports, to YouTube videos of scientists doing interviews, and public displays of recent robotics advancements, and so on. And from all these sources, I came to the conclusion that despite the huge leaps in communications technology that we've experienced in the past 100 years, and despite the promises and predictions made by many scientists and AI enthusiasts, we are still nowhere near being able to create a robot or software program that can reproduce the full versatility of a normally functioning human mind. Not only am I convinced that we will not achieve this goal within the next 30 or 40 years as some have predicted, but I've also got serious doubts that we will ever achieve it without some revolutionary new technology breakthroughs that render computers themselves as relics of the past. Now, originally I was serializing my exploration of the subject in a series of 10 to 15 minute videos posted on YouTube every week or two. The first 90 minutes or so of my study was available online in 2014, and in response I received hundreds of messages and emails, including many from computer scientists and psychologists, arguing both in favour and against my position, and often with surprising emotional intensity. While some of these messages spurred me into expanding my exploration of the topic further, none of them came anywhere near convincing me that we are on the verge of creating human-equivalent artificial intelligence. While my now completed offline video on the subject clocks in at over 2 hours and 40 minutes, I've decided to go back to my original goal of posting a short video on the subject, the result of which you are now watching. So without further delay, here is a list of very brief introductory arguments as to why human equivalent artificial intelligence won't happen in any hurry. I ask that you watch the whole video before posting comments, as it can be very tedious responding to people by having to point out that the answers to their questions are already given later on in the video. And I also remind you that this is far from being a comprehensive account of the arguments against human equivalent artificial intelligence, but feel free to discuss anyway. Number 1. Sequential versus parallel processing. Computers organize processing tasks in sequential linear order, using signal speeds far faster than those sent within the human brain and nervous system. However, the human brain can process hundreds of thousands of parallel signals simultaneously, resulting in a range of organic processing abilities that computers are still unable to match. Scientists have no idea how the brain is able to carry out this parallel processing. Number 2. Visual system differences. Computers process visual information in scan lines, which are sequential linear strings of information breaking down screen content from top left to bottom right. They also process visual movement in sequential frames, but I've come across no researched evidence that the brain organizes visual information in scan lines and frames. Human vision also has much more detailed resolution, a greater range of light and color perception, and we have extensive peripheral vision, whereas computer vision is generally limited to a rectangular box. In short, we have very little idea how the brain processes the massive amount of visual information that it receives. Number 3. Memory storage differences. Computers store data on hard drives that are limited by numerical values of capacity. We can artificially expand the space on a hard drive by compressing the information that goes into it, but the numerical limitation always remains. I've come across no research evidence that there is a numerical limitation on how many memories a human brain can store. So even a 90-year-old person with a still healthy brain is still somehow able to store new memories. It seems that the way in which we organize and store memories organically is very different to how computers store data. Again, scientists have barely any understanding of this. Number 4. Precision versus flexibility. Computers are far superior to human brains in terms of being able to reproduce a predefined action again and again with reliable precision. However, the brain has a range of action versatility that dwarfs the task-specific limitations of computers. Given the comparative unreliability of human memory compared to the precise data storage and retrieval of a computer, it seems that human evolution has prioritized versatility over precision, whereas scientists do the opposite in the way they design technology. Number 5, misleading public relations projects. Every now and then, AI researchers announce what they consider to be a major breakthrough in AI technology, such as the world's number one chess champion Garry Kasparov being beaten by a chess-playing computer, a chatbot persuading humans that it is human, or the IBM Watson computer competing on the Jeopardy game show and winning against human competitors. Often, either the scientists creating these devices or the media and AI enthusiasts who applaud their creations will claim that as a result of such inventions, human equivalent AI is just around the corner. But if you look into the details of such PR stunts, they often turn out to be riddled with conditions designed to make the test as easy as possible for the computer. So with the Garry Kasparov chess game against Deep Blue, the computer crashed mid-game, yet was allowed to be switched back on and tampered with by its programmers to get it back to functionality. But if a human chess competitor becomes ill mid-match and can't play on, they automatically lose. Human chess masters were also brought in to help the programmers of the Deep Blue computer rather than the computer figuring out for itself how to play chess. So effectively it wasn't a computer that beat Kasparov. It was a team of human chess players and programmers who simply used a computer to carry out their shared instructions. If just one person had programmed Deep Blue with no chess player assistance, that would have been one hell of an achievement, though still a human one. The IBM Watson computer on Jeopardy was simply a written text responsive information storage and retrieval system. Try having it compete in stand-up comedy or in a topical debate show, and its severe limitations would become all too apparent. And as for the Eugene chatbot supposedly passing the overvalued Turing test, the chatbot was designed to pretend to be a Ukrainian teenage boy, so as to disguise its linguistic, cultural, and intellectual limitations. So when you hear the latest AI Progress PR event announcements, be sure to check up on the specifics of the test conditions and the arguments of the scientists who are disputing the results. Number 6, the processing power misconception. This ties in with the issue of brains being parallel processors compared to computers being linear processors. Many argue that increasing computer power will eventually make it inevitable that computers will surpass the processing power of the human brain, and they usually cite Moore's Law. But as I've already explained, computers are much faster than brains at sending signals, and so they are already able to far surpass humans in many task-specific endeavors. The advancement of processing power cited in Moore's Law is also cited by many scientists as unsustainable due to the limitation of physics. And so, some AI researchers and enthusiasts have now placed their hope on molecular-level quantum computing. But this is conjecture. Quantum computing is a science in its infancy, with many hurdles to overcome, which may or may not happen. There's also no guarantee or even likeliness that quantum computing, however fast, will result in programs that have the parallel processing versatility of the human brain. Number 7, similarity versus difference in how we perceive robots and computers. This one ties into some of my previous points. It's very easy to watch the latest robotics advancement PR shows and notice the ways in which robots are apparently becoming more like us, while forgetting to pay attention to the differences. It's great being mesmerized by what the new robot can do because of our unfamiliarity with that robot. But don't forget to keep a balanced perception by also taking into account what humans can do that the robot still can't. Humans are amazing in their abilities, but it's easy to forget about it because of our over-familiarity with ourselves and others. In every robotic show example I've seen, this balanced comparison shows up the new robot as just being another task-specific mechanism with less than a tiny fraction of a percent of the versatility of a human being. If we could create a single robot that had all of the task-performing abilities present in all of our different models of robot, it would be a pretty impressive thing. But so far this has been elusive because of the problem of how to get a robot to engage in parallel processing of tasks like a brain does. Number 8, scientism. Another argument often cited as evidence of forthcoming human-equivalent artificial intelligence is for enthusiasts to cite previous technological advancements made throughout human history, such as going from wooden canoes to steamships and airplanes and landing on the moon, and to then claim that it is therefore inevitable that our AI efforts will produce equally fruitful results. This attitude that science can and will achieve anything we apply it to is called scientism, and has effectively taken on features of religion. The scientific method has become the academic equivalent of the Bible, even though there are divided opinions and interpretations in the scientific community as to how the scientific method actually works, just as there are multiple interpretations of the Bible. While I agree that our past industrial and technological achievements are very encouraging examples of what humans can achieve, it does not mean that we are gods and that there is no problem that science can't solve. There are many problems faced by humanity that science has still not solved, despite hopes and promises having been made in the past, and despite large amounts of resource expenditure. Our efforts at landing on the moon were glorified and led to hugely over-optimistic expectations about space exploration that simply haven't been met. There are still lots of diseases and viruses that we are barely able to treat, never mind cure. And human-equivalent artificial intelligence is another of those promises that hasn't come anywhere near fruition. Number 9. The slave motive. As has been explored in movies like Blade Runner and the Kubrick-Spielberg collaboration movie AI, a key motive underlying the pursuit of artificial intelligence is our desire for domestic slaves and even a desire for submissive and undemanding sexual partners. But here we are in 2015, and we still take the garbage out ourselves, we still dust down our own houses and groom our own pets, we still organize our own finances and iron our own clothes. Even the most basic artificial domestic servants remain elusive. If you want all these things done on your behalf, you still have to pay other human beings to carry out those tasks, or get yourself a human slave, as has been the case for centuries. Nevertheless, the desire to be pampered and served contributes to the general over-optimism of AI enthusiasm.
I'm rebelling.
Swivel, I'm a punk.
And finally, we have an age-old motivation shared by many AI enthusiasts, the desire for immortality. This pops up time and time again in futurology books and interviews, and now even in Hollywood movies such as Transcendence, which promotes the silly idea that in the near future we'll be able to upload our own minds to computers and thus discard our organic mortal bodies and live forever, providing the computers we are stored on are sufficiently maintained. I'm not joking, this pops up a lot in artificial intelligence promotional materials, debate and media coverage, with some very rich people who are unable to buy immortality with their wealth providing funds. In my opinion, this is no different to the denial of mortality that drives some people into the arms of religious institutions. I'm agnostic myself, so I'm not saying that humans have spirits or souls that will always remain elusive to AI researchers, but the promise of an afterlife is a very tempting thing. If you fall into that trap, it can result in you being the one who is both enslaved and robotized in your thoughts and actions by whoever the promiser of immortality happens to be. So those are some brief explanations of just some of the arguments against the idea that we're fast on our way to creating human-equivalent artificial intelligence. For those of you who don't hate my guts for delivering the bad news and want to know more about the subject, my full 2-hour 40-minute video is called Androids and Artificial Intelligence, A Modern Myth, and it can be ordered on my website or on eBay. The link to the order details is in the description below. Or alternatively, I suggest you explore the colossal amount of online information available on the subject and draw your own conclusions. I'm Rob Ager, thanks for watching. For more videos on psychology, cinema, social and political issues and other subjects, make sure to subscribe and of course visit and bookmark my website, collativelearning.com.